Welcome to CSIS Online. The way we bring you events is changing, but we'll still present live analysis and award-winning digital media from our Dracopolis Ideas Lab, all on your time, live or on demand. This is CSIS Online.
My name is Seth Sender. I'm the director of the Project on History and Strategy here at CSIS. And we're delighted to talk a little history today. The subject is After Disruption, Historical Perspectives on the Future of International Order. I would be equally thrilled if today we were talking about world order in a placid and predictable time, but of course we're not. And the only people who are excited about this amount of disruption are historians because they thrive on studying it. We, of course, are facing geopolitical and economic trends that have been long in the making, that have made many people question whether the American-led order that was built after 1945 is faltering and may need to be renovated. And that, of course, has been compounded by the shock of the COVID pandemic, which has really intensified many of the existing trends and potentially created entirely new dynamics that are going to have to make us rethink the nature of power in the international system. So that raises the question, obviously, of what comes next. And it's actually quite difficult to figure out and imagine what will come after this extraordinary period of turbulence that we're in. One way to provide insight is by asking historians to examine and excavate past periods of disruption in which efforts were made to rethink, reimagine, rebuild order. And what we've done over the course of the last several months is bring together some leading international historians for some workshops to talk about major epochs of order making. What can we learn from those efforts? Why did order break down? How was debate about the future of order affected during that period? And then what order came out of it? We're joined, I'm delighted really to have participated with some really terrific historians, Alec Bick from SAIS and the Kissinger Center, and Glenda Slugga at the University of Sydney, Andrew Earhart, King's College, Dan Gorman at the University of Waterloo, Francine McKenzie, Western Ontario University, Hilary Briff at King's College, and Dan Sargent at Berkeley have all provided really terrific essays and insights based on their area of expertise. We have a terrific report that's just come out that discusses the lessons and insights from these major epochs, and I'd really urge everyone to take a look at that. And the organizing questions really for this effort to excavate history, to learn from history, were in periods of flux, how do different visions of order get resolved? In other words, these are contentious moments in which there are alternate futures. How does one future win out over another? Whose ideas win, in other words? What type of actors actually shape order? Governments, individuals, organizations? And how do they contribute to the making of the new order? Does might always make order? Or can smaller actors and smaller states shape the trajectory of history? And then does order emerge from a series of ad hoc responses to specific problems? Or can a master blueprint, the grand statesman, actually devise an order that can be enacted? And then for our present purposes, probably the most interesting and relevant question is, can a faltering order be rehabilitated, or does it have to be replaced by an entirely new order? So obviously the best thing to do would be to read these wonderful essays from these terrific historians to meditate on the lessons and the analysis. But since we live in the era we live in and we're on Zoom, I have Twitterized all of the lessons and takeaways that you need from this terrific series of essays into 7 points. And then after that, we're left to read history. So point one, order does not snap together like Legos in a single conference. Point two, disruption opens windows for diverse actors to shape order. Point three, ordering is not always architecture. Practical problem solving can actually produce order. Four, disorder can give older ideas new life. Five, contradictions and the seeds of future controversy are often baked into new orders. Six, order requires coalition building, which interestingly enough does offer opportunities and can empower smaller states. And then finally, faltering orders we learn from history can in fact be revised without a major disruption in the international system. They can be rehabilitated. And the analysis underpinning those lessons, of course, is provided in our series of essays. Today, I'm thrilled to be joined by Francine McKenzie, Dan Gorman, Alex Bick to talk about just three of those case studies and what they take away from their deep scholarship on these cases. Our format is going to be a round robin, where each of our historians is going to talk for just a few minutes. Then we'll have a conversation. You have opportunities as the audience to ask questions in the chat box or on the internet, and we're happy to try and integrate those into our conversation as we move along. Thank you again for joining me. And I'd be remiss if I didn't also thank Emma Bates, my collaborator and associate fellow here at CSIS, who's helped to put together our terrific booklet. With that, Alex, why don't you lead us off and take about 5 or 7 minutes.
Great. Thanks, Seth, both for the invitation and for putting this together. It's a really good moment to take this kind of a look historically. And I want to thank you also for allowing me to reach back into the mists of the 17th century. That doesn't happen very often in a Washington policy conversation. But I hope that some of my remarks today will reflect why I think that's still important to do. So I think many people will know that Westphalia, the treaty it's actually a series of treaties that were signed over the course of 1648 that ended both the 80 years war between the Dutch and the Spanish and the 30 years war within the Habsburg Empire, within the Holy Roman Empire in Central Europe. The Treaty of Westphalia is sort of a key element in the development of international relations, and particularly to international relations theorists. So if you look from Hans Morgenthau to Hedley Bull to Henry Kissinger, you always see Westphalia treated as the beginning of international order itself. And there are three primary attributes of Westphalia that each of these theorists and many, many others come back to. The first is that the agreement essentially laid the foundations for the sovereign territorial state as the key actor within the international system. Rather than empires, leagues, or tribes, the state became the core player. Secondly, in the absence of any universal authority, whether that be the Holy Roman Empire or the Catholic Church, states were left to manage the question of order through the balance of power. And then thirdly, on the whole, whereas religion had been a primary motivator for war in the period before 1648, later, you see a diminishment of war as a motivation. Instead, you see the emergence of reason of state, essentially considerations of power and economics, rather than a focus on religious conflict stemming from the Reformation. So as some of you will know, and as certainly the others on this panel know, historians have poked so many holes in this story that it's begun to lose favor. It's been turned essentially into a myth rather than a piece of analysis. And that's particularly true for academic historians, but I think that message has been disseminated more broadly. I'll just hit a couple of these criticisms. There are many places you can read about it online, from very serious scholarship to more policy pieces. But I think, first of all, sovereignty doesn't appear anywhere in the text of the agreement. And empires, leagues, and tribes have continued long after. Think only even today of the European Union, where territorial sovereignty and political sovereignty don't overlap precisely. Secondly, the idea of the balance of power is much older than Westphalia. And in the period after Westphalia, you had efforts by states, notably France in the 19th century and Germany in the 20th century, to dominate Europe, not by balancing power, but by taking it over themselves. And then finally, religion has continued to animate not only states, but many actors in the international system well after the 17th century. So, some people have taken this to essentially throw Westphalia out and say, well, if it wasn't the things that we thought, then perhaps it's of no consequence. And I'd like to offer three points that would push back on that perspective. The first is that Westphalia can still tell us a lot about the speed of change in the international system. Secondly, it can tell us about the nature of sovereignty. And third, it can tell us something about the relationship between changes in order and changes in the economy. So let me do this very quickly. The first point, which Seth has already previewed, is that the changes that are ascribed to Westphalia really took place over 200 or 300 years. They involved major transformations like the Reformation, the decline of feudalism, the French Revolution, the Industrial Revolution, so that the emergence of the state as the cornerstone of the international system really took place over a much, much longer period of time. And that's not to say that Westphalia or that changes in order don't change the ranking of individual states within an order. Out of Westphalia, Spain limped and France came out the most powerful military state on the continent. So who's on top can change very rapidly, but the nature of the order itself changed much, much more slowly. And I think that's the first lesson of Westphalia, which we need to take away in the context of this broader discussion and for Westphalia specifically. Secondly, that as I've already mentioned with the European Union, other models of sovereignty existed long after 1648. The whole European colonial world was largely built on a system of mixed sovereignty, a kind of lumpy sovereignty, as one historian has called it. That existed for hundreds of years into the process of decolonization. And I think rather than relying on an overly idealized sense of a Westphalian state, and rather than comparing, for instance, Western notions of sovereignty and international order to Eastern, here referring primarily to China, but more broadly, Eastern notions of sovereignty and order, it may be more useful to think about how Westphalian sovereignty, the idea of Westphalian sovereignty, is deployed by states, including revisionist powers who are trying to protect their internal affairs or the internal affairs of their allies. I think that's the second lesson. And then finally, with respect to economics, again, I think some people want to throw out Westphalia and say, well, let's just use it as a heuristic if it didn't mean all of the things that we thought it meant previously. And I would make a counter argument, which is where scholars of international relations have focused primarily on diplomacy as the kind of gauge of change. If you look at economics, there's a whole other story about Westphalia that is of tremendous importance to how we think about some of the challenges today. And that story is really that in looking at the 30 years war and the 80 years war together, contemporaries were perplexed at how a small state, in this case, the Dutch Republic, it had been a small alliance of cities and towns, had been able to defeat the greatest army in Europe, the Army of Flanders, which was deployed by the Spanish king. And the answer to that was that the Dutch had grown their economy. They had brought in immigrants, skilled immigrants from across Europe. They had regulated the economy in ways that gave preference to key industries that made them competitive. And they used treaties to gain economic advantage. And the lesson, the kind of broader lesson that statesmen across Europe, in France at first, but in Spain, ultimately in Russia, and really all across Europe, the lesson that people drew was that trade couldn't be left to the small republics. It was a matter of state. It had to be taken seriously by the great monarchies. Trade couldn't be left to craftsmen. It had become essentially a matter of state. If you couldn't compete, it's not just that you wouldn't be as wealthy, it's that you would be potentially prey for other states in the system. And so over the next century, you saw a revolution in the way that people thought about economic problems and their relationship to problems of security. Today, we call that discipline political economy. It emerged in that century after Westphalia, and specifically in response to some of the problems or some of the challenges and some of the outcomes of those two wars. So what's the lesson here? I think the first is that President Trump's sort of mercantilist language and fascination with mercantilist ideas is not purely idiosyncratic. In moments of profound transformation in the international system, we come back to some of the orthodoxies that had existed before, and they need to be renewed. And I think this demands renewed thinking in the United States and Europe today. And secondly, or to be a little bit more precise, the questions that were asked at that time were, do the people who think about trade and the people who think about security, can those be separate people? Or do the institutions of government need to be able to integrate knowledge and expertise on those issues? What is the relationship between military alliances and trade agreements? How can immigration, as I've said from the Dutch example, how can immigration be brought into a discussion of national competitiveness? And what industries need to be nurtured and how in order to ensure that a state can be strong and endure in the competition that it's likely to face. So again, I don't want to overdraw the analogy, but very similar questions were asked in the wake of Westphalia that I believe need to be asked today as we think about an alternative model presented by China and how we, in the United States at least, organize ourselves for the competition ahead.
Terrific, Alex. Thank you. And we'll come back to that question of emulation and lessons in the conversation. Dan, why don't you take over?
Sure. So I can easily talk about the legacies of the First World War and the peace settlements that follow it in 1918 into the early 1920s in 5 or 6 minutes. So I will attempt to do so. I mean, to go back to the quote from George Kennan that the First World War was the seminal catastrophe of the 20th century, I think is particularly fitting for the project that we all put together over the summer. Because it's really a pivot moment, I think, in the history of international orders, at least in the last several centuries. So looking back and touching on what Alex has just talked about, as well as some of the other contributions in our project, Glenda Sluga talks about the Congress system that comes out of the conference at Vienna that ends the Napoleonic Wars. Andrew Earhart talks about the sort of international network of bureaus and cooperative networks dealing specifically with questions of international health. And these issues all come to a head, amongst many others, of course, from 1914 until the aftermath of the war itself. And the First World War, of course, vis-a-vis our current crises, has been drawn on for all sorts of analogies, in part because we're now at the centenary. That's an entirely arbitrary sort of historical concept, but we're drawn to those centenaries to think about these things. And there are all sorts of parallels, of course, with our between the First World War and its peace settlements and our current crises, not least of which, of course, is a global pandemic, but also challenges to an international order, at least a status quo anti-international order. Questions of refugee crises coming out of the First World War, which in many ways parallel what's going on across the world in many places today, and so forth and so on. So there are similar situations there at play. Looking forward, Francine will talk about the peace settlement coming out of the Second World War in a moment, as well as Daniel Sargent's piece on the international order closer to the present, and Hilary Griffith's work on small states. Of course, the peace settlements that come out of the First World War anticipate and in some ways set the parameters for the development of the international order going forward. So in those ways, as well as many others, the First World War is really a pivot point. So what happened at that point that is perhaps relevant for our thinking about the international order and where we might go in 2020? Well, first of all, like today, there were an almost innumerable set of crises occurring at the same time. So the peacemakers coming out of the war, the statesmen that meet at Versailles, but also who negotiate the six other peace treaties that come out of the First World War in different ways, beginning with the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk earlier in 1918, which settled the conflict between Russia and Germany, as well as the other peace treaties that deal with the other defeated central powers, try to address all of these issues at once. So the conventional view of the Treaty of Versailles, and more broadly the peace settlement that comes out of the First World War, is that it failed. And in many ways, that's true, in my view, not least of which because the key goal of collective security, of creating stability, not necessarily fixing the problems that at least some people thought had caused the First World War, but of creating stability, of course, especially by the 1930s, failed. We can ask whether or not other factors came into play there and so forth and so on. But at least on its face, the peace treaties that come out, or the peace settlement after the First World War, was a failure. But in many other ways, I think it was a success. And it was a success because it set the framework or the parameters for many of the networks and institutions and ideas and means of achieving international cooperation that we're still talking about today in terms of a liberal international order. And I point to three ideas that really come out of the peace settlements after the First World War. First, the concept of international law. The idea that states and more broadly other actors can somehow create binding agreements that going forward will create some framework of stability to deal with future crises, both anticipated and unanticipated. Second, and related to that, is the practice of multilateralism. the idea of bringing together states, and again, after the First World War, also lots of other non-state actors, together on an ongoing basis to solve problems. That had gone on, of course, before 1919, obviously, and some of the pieces in our project deal with examples of that. But we have an intensification of that practice of international relations, if you will. International relations itself as a discipline emerges from efforts to try to address the problems of the First World War. And that's not a coincidence. And finally, the various peace settlements after the First World War were territorial settlements. And that goes back to some of the issues of sovereignty that Alex has talked about. So when at least I think about the peace settlements that come into the First World War, what amongst the many things that they did was to internationalize the prevailing concept or concepts of sovereignty prevalent in Europe in the early 20th century. And other states and actors around the world, to various degrees, were forced to come to terms with that European idea of sovereignty. Some take it on and try to become members of the prevailing international system, like Japan. Others contest it, what becomes the Soviet Union, obviously, but lots of other powers as well. So those three ideas, I think, are really important. And then some of the lessons that I drew just quickly from those peace settlements coming out of the First World War, first of all, and this goes back to a point you made a few moments ago, Seth, that crises, international crises, provide an opportunity for idea entrepreneurs to, if you will, sell their wares. Sometimes those ideas are created at the time, but more often than not, they're ideas that are, if you will, already on the shelf, ideas that have been debated and thought about often for many centuries. But it's the crises or the set of parallel crises that offer opportunities for some of those ideas and practices to be put into practice. Second, crises are opportunities for change, but they don't necessitate it. So just like after the First World War, so too it seems to me today that yes, we're living through a period of acute international crises, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we will have going forward a radically altered international order. We might, and we might want to, but there may be lots of other factors that should stand in the way of those developments. Third, shared international connections didn't die away after the First World War. If you'll pardon the pun, many of those shared international connections trumped nationalism, even into the interwar period, where in many ways, of course, nationalism is one of the predominant causes of the Second World War itself. But a lot of those international connections that had been developed before and during the First World War continue in the interwar period, as well as after 1945. So I'll just point to one example, and that's the creation through the League of Nations and some of the other international institutions that develop in the interwar period of an international civil service. The creation of an international bureaucracy that sees its task or its tasks as serving a broader international purpose, as opposed to simply being delegates or representatives of their own nation states. And finally, both coming out of the First World War and today, and here's where maybe there's a danger of over-relying on historical analogies, we're in love with the war metaphor. We conduct wars on drugs, we conduct wars on COVID, we conduct wars on all kinds of things. Well, we can conduct wars on states after the First World War either won or lost the war, but it's less clear what a war on a social or a health crisis looks like. How does one declare victory? Who are the victorious powers? And the very analogy of war, the metaphor of war, suggests that there are losers. Well, looking at international health or social crises, including the current pandemic, nobody wants losers. We want some sort of a solution, whether that's a vaccine or whatever happens down the road. And that really points to, I think, one of the important legacies to finish up coming out of the First World War, and that is that legacy of international cooperation, that we can have cooperation and conflict at the same time and between the same actors. They're not mutually exclusive. And I think sometimes we can fall into that sort of binary trap of thinking about international relations and international orders as either providing stability and cooperation or being failures and leading to instability. So that's the First World War in 5 or 6 minutes.
You did it, Dan. You managed to consolidate one of the most catastrophic and complex events in 7 minutes. Francine.
Thanks. Just as with the Peace of Westphalia and Paris in 1919, World War II is widely seen as a time when a new global order was established. And this is usually characterized as an American creation. But the story of an American-made and American-led order is one interpretation of how the UN system came to be. And my contribution to After Disruption is a historical dissection of the Second World War that reveals additional, and I think some critical elements that explain how that order emerged, and that I think have implications for how we think about the challenge to the global order today. So, like Alex and Dan, I will just talk about a few of those additional factors, but some that also pick up on themes that run across the other case studies in After Disruption. So, first point, moments matter to the creation of global order, but so does what came before and what came after. Without a doubt, the timing and context of the Second World War were critical to the creation of the UN system. What the Allies had at stake, which they regarded as their very survival, made it possible for them to compromise, to reach agreements on the very difficult decisions they had to confront about what that post-war order would look like. The context of the war also helped to bring a clarity to their understanding of what their priorities should be. And the experience of the war also helped to offset or counter mistrust and rivalry amongst the greatest powers, or amongst all the members of the United Nations, but the greatest powers in particular, the United States, Great Britain, and the Soviet Union, and remind them of the benefits of working together. In addition, I think the experience of the Second World War inculcated a deep sense of obligation to make the world better. It was a way of atoning for the cost and devastation of the Second World War. John Winant, the American ambassador to Britain during the war, captured some of these ideas. In 1944, he said, "Tragic and costly as this war has been, it has for the time being destroyed much that is bad." And he noted that they had the opportunity to create, quote, a new and better pattern. But he also added that the opportunity would be fleeting. So timing was crucial. But as Seth, Alex, and Dan have all pointed out, orders are not created in a moment. And the wartime conferences and summits and decisions that were made about the UN and the affiliated organizations that surrounded it, that became the UN system, they were tentative beginnings. Moreover, these organizations were built on old ideas and old practices in international relations, and they worked themselves out in practical ways as it moved forward, as they moved forward. As Daniel Sargent put it in his study in After Disruption, order is a work in perpetual progress. Second point. Leaders are key to global orders, but far-reaching support is essential. If we were to put together a chronology of how the UN system was created, we might begin with Franklin Roosevelt's Four Freedoms speech, or perhaps the Atlantic Charter. And without a doubt, American leadership was essential to the creation of the UN system. But that leadership was discharged in many ways, including in cultivating multilateral support, which I think was essential for the legitimacy of the United Nations. And it was clear in wartime deliberations that the support of the non-great powers would not be automatic, would not be forthcoming, if the new global order was simply dominated by the greatest powers or tailored to serve their interests above all. As Trygve Lie, Norway's foreign minister during the war, and of course later the first Secretary General of the United Nations, put it in 1942, quote, "We're not fighting against the new German order merely to go into a new Anglo-American order." Hilary Berfa's contribution to After Disruption looks at how small states maneuver within the international order, and also the ways in which they matter and strengthen that order. I think that's an important point to keep in mind today. Third point, the UN system had built-in tensions and flaws. Now, World War II is usually seen as a high point in internationalist thought and internationalist action. And the international organizations that were set up within the UN system, they had supporters across governments and they had champions outside of government. Glenda Sluga, in her study of the Congress of Vienna, calls these people influencers, or as Dan just referred to them, idea entrepreneurs. And their support was crucial to the UN system because there were critics to this project from the outset. In particular, people who objected to any kind of limitation on national sovereignty, or who resisted putting collective interests on a par with national interests. In the 1940s, nationalist and internationalist logics were both at play. And this is something Andrew Earhart looks at in his chapter, his study on pandemics in the 19th century, that the same crisis could elicit nationalist and internationalist reactions simultaneously, which complicates the process of moving forward or dealing with practical problems. So in the 1940s, though, these two logics were both at play and they were powerful. And the job of international relations was to restrain nations and extreme nationalist actions, which were seen, as Dan just said, as one of the root causes of the Second World War. But nations also remained the primary actors in the post-war order, and they both supported and resisted international organizations, as we see today. And this put international organizations in an unwinnable position. If they were proactive, coordinated responses amongst governments, suggested policies for their members, they would be criticized for being too authoritative or for encroaching on national sovereignty. But if they waited for their members to give them instruction or direction, then they would also be criticized for being too passive or deferential. In short, international organizations were put in a position where their natural condition would be beleaguered. And this means that the UN system is imperfect and it is messy, but it is also workable. A final thought. Many contributors to After Disruption, these historians, they're cautious about the lessons of history and guarded about the utility of historical analogies. The past is not a straightforward guide to the present, but it matters to our understanding today. And one of the ways that I think history matters to our understanding today is that it helps us to ask apt questions about the future of international order. So for those who believe the time has come to create a new order, we should ask, what will the purpose of that order be? And will that purpose elicit far-reaching support? For those who believe that the international order can be salvaged, we should consider whether or not that nationalist-internationalist dynamic can coexist. Can a sustainable balance be found between them? And finally, in trying to gauge the gravity of the current challenge to the global order, we should consider whether we are in a true moment of crisis or whether the global order is going through a moment of acute, and I would say high stakes adaptation, as it has done before. And I'll stop there.
Francine, that's brilliant. I also feel better to know that order can be imperfect, contradictory, but still workable. That provides a little faith for all of us. So I think we'll open it up to a conversation between the four of us, and for folks who would like to try and ask questions through Zoom, they can, and we'll try and answer those from our audience. I'm going to ask a very basic question to start. Are there ways we can think about who wins the contest over ordering debates? Are there patterns, trends? Certainly smaller actors have agency, but when it comes down to it, say the victors in wars, those who deal most effectively with a pandemic, are those who ultimately are the key driver of a new order? So I think, you know, that could be for Francine, why don't you start with that? We can move backwards.
Thanks, Seth. I certainly think there have been winners and losers in the international, in the way different international orders have been created. But, you know, depending, whether you think of yourself as a winner or loser will depend on how you think about the world order in the first place. And so when I think about debates that are going on today, those, for instance, who are critical of the World Health Organization, or who are resisting international coordination, or governments that are trying to secure deals for vaccines or hoarding PPE supplies, one gets a sense that there's still a really strong commitment to the idea of looking after the well-being of your citizens first and foremost. That is your highest obligation. And so the international solution might seem to compromise that. On the other hand, those who argue, I would say with equal persuasiveness and force, perhaps not quite as much force, that international coordination is absolutely essential. We cannot deal with COVID or other crises or other practical challenges effectively unless it's in conjunction with one another. They'll see the national responses as antithetical to that. So I think whether you're a winner or loser depends on how you see the world and how you make sense of it in the first place.
Maybe I'll dodge the question in a similar way. It depends. So like Francine said, thinking about the peace settlements of the First World War, in some ways it depends on what the interests of the various actors that we might be talking about were and are coming into a moment where international order is being changed. So after the First World War, of course, we have a series of peace conferences. So we can talk about an actual moment as opposed to, as Alex talked about with Westphalia, that we don't have a sort of turning point in 1648, you know, the lights are switched on and off, but really a long process afterwards. So if we think about the peace settlements coming out of the First World War, on the one hand, it's the, yes, victorious powers, but really the hegemonic or dominant powers coming into a crisis that at least have an advantage. They have the weight of inertia. So when we think about lessons from the past, it may not be a one-to-one relationship, but we can look at historical inertia. So coming out of the First World War, yes, the victors are dictating the terms of the peace settlements, but they also are able to rely upon their pre-existing hegemonic or preeminent position in the international system itself. So they can be winners, depending on how you look at it. But paradoxically, if we think about the outcome of the First World War, some of the quote-unquote winners, at least if we understand winners in terms of states or actors that secured their own goals or interests, but which obviously were not in the interests of the global community, were paradoxically the various defeated or aggrieved powers that rejected the international settlement coming out of the First World War. So if we think about, you know, sort of the well-used concept of the prisoner's dilemma, whether it's Germany or the Soviet Union or Japan, and to a lesser extent, Italy, it's states that rejected or were rejected from the international settlements coming out of the First World War that actually reaped the benefits of not being members of the international system in the interwar period, at least in terms of securing their own goals. And ironically, we can perhaps see that coming, see that sort of dynamic made apparent coming out of the Second World War, where Japan and West Germany are incorporated immediately by conquest, obviously, but incorporated immediately into the post-1945 international order. So at least thinking of it in those terms, it can be smaller actors that get squeezed out, that they have less of a say in creating or changing an international order. And then going forward, they have at least less autonomy, not no autonomy, but less autonomy or agency to shift where a newly established international order might be going.
Thanks, Seth. It's a great question. I'll be very brief. I mean, I think the hard and perhaps unfortunate answer is, as you've just heard from the others, that the victors in the war set the terms of the peace. The Westphalian Agreement really represents the victory of France, the Dutch Republic, the Protestant German states, and Sweden over the Holy Roman Empire. And the victors came out and set the terms. So in a very narrow sense, I think the lesson is fairly clear there. But I would add two components. The first is I've sort of discussed already, which is, the Dutch came out a victor from this set of settlements, but they went in as an upstart. And I think if you look at the 100-year period after Westphalia, as I've described it, what was a very small player in European politics before the mid-17th century really set the terms for how every state in Europe thought about their strategic situation. So I do think that a smaller or marginal is probably too strong, but a small peripheral power can have an outsized influence on the nature of the system that comes after. And I think there's also, and this is my second point, we should be careful about assuming that winners and losers are a simple binary. The main focus for each of the states on the Protestant alliance, which included France during the 30 Years' War and the 80 Years' War, was to break up the Holy Roman Empire and Habsburg power. They did so, and Spain, as I said, limped away from the agreement. But they did so, and in the process created France as a greater menace in some ways than Spain had been previously. And there you can see very clearly, certainly in the Dutch records, the moment at which Dutch statesmen recognized that their alliance with France against Spain was ultimately creating a force that was closer to them and potentially would be more dangerous over time. So, you know, I don't want to overdraw parallels there, but it's not simply winners and losers. It's a shift in the overall balance of power, and that balance can play out in ways that weren't anticipated as the alliances are put together on the way in.
Can I just tack on a couple of points to that? I think it's worth underlining, and this comes across in many of the essays, that if orders are created in a moment with a at one time with a specific particular purpose in mind, there are lots of unintended consequences. So how it affects states moving forward is not something that's clear at the moment that these orders take a shape, more or less. And the other thing is, I agree, the idea of winners and losers is an overly stark binary. But in a way, if we think about what would be then the ideal response to a global order to ensure that it has the most far-reaching support, it's probably a compromise in which no one's entirely happy. So actually, if you want, you know, arguably the historical lessons would suggest a strong global order, it's one in which everyone is a little bit unhappy with it, and then you've reached a true compromise.
Let me take a question from Rachel, who has asked us, scholars have argued that the expanding role and power of influence of corporations in some ways is filling or overtaking the roles of states. So do you think we're on the cusp or in the midst of a new order building effort in which corporations play a significant role? And maybe the historical component of that is, you know, how do the growth not just of NGOs or individuals, but corporate power affect order making efforts with historical perspective in mind? And Alex, you might be the best person to start with that, given your extensive work on this.
Well, this question's sort of right up my alley. I mean, I think it's a complex question, and it's not one that has a simple, linear and satisfactory answer for all historical time periods. But I don't think that we're in a time right now where corporate power is going to overwhelm state power. I mean, I think we've gone through a moment where the balance between the two definitely tilted in the direction of large corporations. But I think as competition between China, the United States, Russia to a lesser extent, the EU, takes hold on the international system in the way that I think there is clear evidence of already, I think the role of the state is going to come back to the fore. I think you will find that who succeeds ultimately in that competition is going to have something to do with the kind of indigenous internal development of those corporations, of their innovation, their productivity, et cetera. But it's also going to come from how states manage those companies, how they regulate them, how they direct them. You know, if you reach back to Westphalia, there's a, or at least to the period of Westphalia, in the Dutch case, which is the one I'm most familiar with, the East India Company and the West India Company were created at the beginning of the century. Many historians see them essentially as private organizations that were created to trade one company to Asia, the other to the Western Hemisphere. And so historians from the 19th century, thinking about the corporate model as we understand it today or at that time, have really looked at these as private organizations and thought about what made them profitable, what made them unprofitable, and thought of their relationship to the state as essentially one where the state created the environment for them to exist. And over the last couple decades, revisionist scholarship has found pretty convincingly that both of those companies were created for strategic reasons. To keep the Dutch from undermining their own strength in Asia, and with the West India Company specifically to fight what was coming back online after a 12-year truce to prosecute the war against Spain and to hit Spain at the origins of its wealth in the New World. This is the silver that came from Mexico and what's now Bolivia, as well as the slave trade and other sources of wealth for the Spanish Empire. And so I think as we think today about corporations, we have to think both about their contribution to the national economy in a more narrowly economic sense, but we also have to think about their contribution to national power. And I think you'll find an effort across the board, certainly as China has been doing for some time now, to use and to instrumentalize corporations to achieve national objectives. So I think in short, my answer to your question is this relationship changes over time, but I would anticipate a greater role of the state in managing companies going forward rather than the opposite.
And let me follow up on that, Alex. If there's a growing role for the state in order making enterprises, is there going to be a tension between nationalist impulses and internationalist impulses? I think the answer is yes. But what would an order making exercise look like that was driven by nationalist rather than internationalist impulses? I think the question is if internationalism is on the wane in public opinion or perception, could you still have an order based on nationalist agendas? Maybe this is best for someone like Dan looking at that real tension coming out of World War One. No. But I defer.
I mean, the answer is yes. I mean, we will have an international order going forward because we always have one, whether it's a single international order, a single framework within which actors operate, or as was the case perhaps more so in previous centuries, multiple international orders or regional orders as we might look at it at the same time. So an international order of international orders. I mean, coming to the First World War, of course, the international order that emerges is in many ways just what you suggested, a national or a nationalist international order, in the sense that it was comprised of nation states that had developed or at least adapted means of relating with each other. And as Francine talked about in terms of the post-45 settlement, many of the kind of cooperative institutions and ideas that I was talking about earlier were unintended consequences or at least secondary consequences of the peace settlement in the eyes of the peacemakers themselves. Even the League of Nations, which has bequeathed us lots of cooperative networks and ideas, the predecessor to the WHO is the League's health organization, for instance. These were all ideas created in service of what the peacemakers saw as an international order framed around national competition. But as some international relations theorists like to say, the anarchy of the international system is what states make of it. So we can have a more sort of fractured international order where states pursue, more commonly understood nationalist interest. But we can also have an international system where states remain the primary actors, where there is conflict and so forth and so on. But states have developed methods of interacting. That's what diplomacy is, after all. So states, when they want to protest the actions of other states, often a first step is to withdraw their representative. And that really speaks to the importance of diplomacy as an element of international orders.
We have another terrific question here, which is one issue that we haven't talked about is environmental factors, including climate change, and how that might affect the entire dynamics of efforts to remake order. How, based on our case studies from the past, do we think environmental factors or these deeper, broad structural issues affect these efforts at order making, these exercises?
Can I try for that one? When I think about the experience of the Second World War, what is striking to me is that there was a sense amongst the members of the United Nations that their survival was at stake, and it allowed them to set aside differences, competition, rivalry, mistrust, and have a clear purpose in mind about what kind of order they needed so that they could survive and hopefully thrive. One would think that climate change should create the same kind of dynamic, right? That, or context, that our survival is at stake as a result of climate change. And yet the reaction to climate change is not just one that elicits in some ways very strong internationalist support and activism, or a local movements that believe we must change the way we behave. It also elicits rejections of the science of climate change, nationalist responses, thinking whereby economic interests always seem to come ahead of longer term considerations about the survival of the planet. So climate change is really quite discouraging, I think, because if ever there was an issue right now that should make it possible to come together to overcome differences and work towards a long range future, one would think climate change would be it. And it doesn't seem to happen yet. And including in, you know, a country like Canada, where we think of ourselves, I saw our governments have positioned themselves as do-gooding and supportive of constructive internationalist causes, our record on climate change is not good. So I wish that climate change would have that same kind of powerful coalescing or bringing together of interests. They clarify what really matters, and yet I think it hasn't.
Seth, if I could just add to that, I'll make two quick points. The first is that new analysis, essentially, new historical work on the 17th century has found that you had crises not just in Central Europe, but really all around the globe. A number of scholars have begun to tie that to what's called by climatologists the Little Ice Age of the 17th century, where you had declining crop production, you had changing, you had a greater frequency of extreme weather events, and you had changed trade patterns based on changes in the way that the ocean itself behaved. And so I think if you think about Westphalia not simply as a settlement of a local problem, but as a settlement, one among many settlements, of a global crisis, which may have had an important climate component, you begin to think of the global crisis of the 17th century rather than something more local. And I don't think that work has been completed yet, but how that affected global order at the time, I think, is a really important question. And then the second thing I'd say is simply that we talk about climate change as a potential source of conflict, but as Francine has just said, it's also a source potentially of cooperation. And if I think back on my own experience in the Obama administration, one of the few areas on which the United States and China were able to reach really meaningful cooperation was climate. And that's clearly a national security priority for the Chinese. And it's a national security priority, I would argue, for the United States, although obviously some in the current administration don't share that view. So looking forward at a moment where there may be increased nationalism, increased competition, and there will be a great challenge of channeling that competition into nonviolent kinds of interaction, a kind of bright spot potentially is climate as a way of bringing the world's nations, including China and the United States, together.
All right. One of the great joys of my job is I get to invite historians to talk to the policy community who wouldn't normally do so, and they get to pontificate on what happened in the past. And then I get to ask historians what is going on and to give us advice. I think you have each provided some lessons from the past, but what I'd like to know is, given all of these case studies we have on eras of disruption and order, where do you think we are right now? And what do you anticipate coming next? So are we in a period leading up to more disorder? Are we in a moment in which there is a real opportunity here to renovate, say, the liberal internationalist order? Or are we at a period in which there's a likelihood of a new order replacing the current one? So let's go in reverse order. Francine, why don't you go first? Where are we?
Now, Seth, you know historians don't like predicting the future.
It's very complicated, I know.
We're always asked to do so. My own, I suppose, sense is mixed. There are reasons to be optimistic and reasons to be deeply pessimistic about what's coming. Next, the China-US relationship is obviously fraught and perilous. What I find really interesting right now is the sense in the debates about the global order and this the idea that it's an American order. If America is not the leader of this order, if its values and purpose don't define that order, to many people that is seen as catastrophic. So the idea of having any kind of replacement, it will provoke resistance. And yet, arguably, there are so many other ways of thinking about the world and global order in a way which serves the interests of all. Which doesn't have to be an American-made order. There is time. It is a time for, I suppose, an inclusive discussion about what the order should be and what its purpose should be moving forward. And you see glimmers of action, actually, often among small states where they're dealing with crises to international institutions like the World Trade Organization, the World Health Organization, trying to broker new agreements moving forward. My own sense is that actually a complete reconstruction. I'm just not sure all the elements are in place to allow that to happen, or there's an understanding of just how monumental and hubristic that undertaking is. So I suspect there will be reform, and I think there must be reform to that order. The world has changed from the 1940s. But how it will be arrived at is not always clear to me, but I think there will be resistance to it, and it will be difficult moving forward. But I think these institutions also are in some ways cognizant of the challenge, and that the mandate that they were given in the 1940s is in need of refurbishment.
I'll throw caution to the wind and make bold predictions that nobody will perhaps remember tomorrow. But I mean, coming out of the First World War, we had an international order that was framed consciously by peacemakers. You know, we think back to the Clemenceaus and the Lloyd Georges, Woodrow Wilson, obviously, as peacemakers, people who at the time were conscious of, and indeed in their various different ways, desired to reframe an international order. We're not in a position now where that's going to happen. There's not going to be some sort of an international conference on COVID or, racial problems or, refugee crisis or what have you. What we may see going forward is a modern or present day sort of variation or iteration of earlier international orders. So as I spoke about a few moments ago, international orders of international orders. So whether that's regional bodies, working together, on common problems. Somebody talked about climate change earlier. Whether that is the ever denser network of non-state actors. You know, we still call them non-state actors as if states are dominant and all non-state actors are somehow peripheral or derivative of. But in many ways, systems of global governance today have sidelined states in some issues, in terms of some issues. So one of the things that comes out of the first, or came out of the First World War, appropriate for an event hosted by CSIS, is the idea of think tanks, is the idea of people outside of at least formal governmental structures participating in broader policy discussions. What is now Chatham House, what is now the Council on International Affairs, of course, directly came out of the peace negotiations at Versailles. The founders of those organizations founded those bodies while they were in France. And that really speaks to, I think, a world of global governance in 2020, where yes, of course, states are still important, but so too, and I think increasingly, are non-state actors. So the idea of an international order negotiated amongst states at conferences or whatever, I'm not sure that idea is, at least in my view, tenable anymore. How many failed UN conferences have we had over the decades? So I think moving forward, states are not unimportant, obviously, but we need to draw in more of these other actors so that some of these common action problems, if you will, disease, climate change, and so forth, can be adequately addressed. We can't opt out of those problems, regardless of whether we wish to or not.
I agree with a lot that's been said already. I guess I would add 4 points. The first, I heard someone say that the COVID has made the handshake obsolete. And I think one thing that's very clear to historians as a group of people is that change takes place much more slowly, and that people tend to project forward relatively recent events without thinking about other analogies drawn from other time periods. And I think there's some of that going on. So my first point would be to say that I actually think the international order itself is probably going to be much more enduring than the doomsday sayers right now. But I think it will change in some ways. I think, and this is my second point, I think the issues on which there will be international cooperation will change. We've already talked about climate. I think that's an area where you're likely to see greater international cooperation. I think you're going to see less international cooperation on dealing with collapsed states and intrastate conflict, which is an area where there's been relatively, where international cooperation has been very important over the last 25 years. And that means a slightly different role, I think, for the UN and for other intergovernmental organizations, which were solving a different set of problems. Third, I think you're going to get a shift in a shift in alliances and alliance structures, not a night and day shift, but there will be changes to adapt to a different balance of military power in the world right now. And then fourthly, and this I've said in a couple of ways already, I think you're going to see statesmen feel an increasing need, and I think publics an increasing comfort with the state taking a greater role in the economy. And I don't mean the Soviet model of a directed economy is going to come back either for the Soviet Union or for anyone else. But I do mean, I think you're going to see greater comfort and greater interest among political leaders in finding ways to grow the domestic economy, in bringing domestic economic issues and international economic issues and strategy issues together, investing in big projects like the Kennedy administration did on putting a man on the moon that go across a wide range of different areas and spur investment and spur innovation throughout the economy. And so I think that is an important change, and I think that we'll see that with increasing frequency over the next couple of decades.
Terrific, Alex. Thank you. We're nearing the end of our hour. Actually, we've hit the end of our hour. Thank you, everybody, for joining us today. I really urge you to pick up our report on our website. It's a terrific series of essays covering 400 years of history in 70 pages. You can't ask for more synthesis than that. Terrific insights, lessons that are, I think, really relevant for our current conditions. Not all of them American-centric, internationalist in orientation. I think my own view, and one that, struck me as I was reading all of these essays and listening to these conversations, is how important emulation is to the future of order. And it does seem that, the parties that win the wars revitalize their economies, mitigate the crisis, provide the common vision that offers the most benefit to the most people around the world, are going to have the greatest leverage in shaping order. Emulation, of course, is not just the sincerest form of flattery. It is also the surest sign of successful order in the making. And, as we look ahead, I do worry that the appeal of democracy, free markets, and the international architecture designed, as Francis said, not just by the United States, but by the United States and its many partners, state and non-state, does face challenge. And the extent to which it can be renovated, rehabilitated, and strengthened really does hinge on whether the American people, its government, its partners, state and non-state around the world, are capable of proving worthy of emulation and adaptation. And if they collectively fail, I do think it's pretty clear in the international environment we're in right now, there are definitely other ideas, programs, and visions waiting happily to construct alternative visions of order that I think are not going to be nearly as beneficial to humanity as the ones that we've helped to build. That is, perhaps a little too presentist and not enough history, but I have that prerogative. Thank you all for joining us today. I really appreciate it. Francine, Dan, Alex, terrific scholarship, and it's been a real pleasure. Thank you, guys.